Tonight, the farming methods that make chicken so cheap. The supermarket meat that's not what it seems to be.
That's well out of order.
And why Chef Raymond Blanc turned his nose up at some supermarket ready meals.
Oh my God. That to me, that's a crime against humanity.
The supermarket's high street stranglehold is changing the way we eat as well as shop. Tonight, we take a trolley down the aisles to lift the lid on some supermarket secrets. It's become an integral part of family life, the weekly trip to the supermarket for the family food shop. The major supermarket chains seem to have grown into a kind of shopper's paradise. Cheap food perfectly presented, a range and variety that would have been undreamt of 50 years ago. So what's the problem? I'm a working journalist with three kids, and as far as I'm concerned, my local supermarket is a godsend. I can pick up all of the food I want in a single trip. And what's more, it's all top quality stuff and cheap too. Well, at least that's what the supermarkets would have us believe. Sunday lunch, 1950s style. Mr. and Mrs. Average Briton sit down with the kids to an extra special treat. A nice bit of chicken, roast potatoes, and two seasonal veg.
Dominic!
Fast forward 50 years and that chicken has magically transformed from an expensive treat into Britain's staple diet. But now it's likely to be pre-packed, pre-prepared and ready to eat. And we're eating four times as many chickens as 30 years ago. Or to put it another way, literally billions of thighs, breast, wings and drumsticks. Chicken tikka masalas, chicken Kievs, chicken pies, chicken escallops, chicken nuggets, chicken goujons and southern fried chicken. But there's a price to pay for all this cheap food, and it's not just a financial one. I've come deep into the rural heart of England to visit a highly successful, ultra-modern business.
Hello. Hello, Jane.
How are you?
Very pleased to meet you.
Nice to see you.
Alan Simpson has built a facility which uses the most up-to-date technologies available. It's well-run and super efficient.
It's one of the largest independent units in the UK.
It doesn't look like something I would traditionally call a farm.
No, I think it's moved a long way from the early days. We have, unfortunately, and I hate to use the word, you know, become a factory farm, but that's exactly what we are. We're factory farming.
His farm produces over 2 million units every year. Most of them end up on supermarket shelves in the fresh meat aisles. Alan Simpson grows chickens the modern way. So this is all pretty high-tech. What does this all do? Is it temperature?
All the houses are, the environment is controlled. Daily temperatures, the lighting patterns, how much ventilation the bird receives. It takes care of it all by computer.
Okay.
Now then, before we go in there, I must ask you, no quick movements.
Right.
You are going to find this something different than you've seen before. So I'm asking you not to be too alarmed by it. If you move quietly, the birds will soon become adjusted to you.
Okay, you got me worried now, Alan.
No. But you don't start any sharp movements to start.
Right.
Okay, just let them.
Are you going to go
in first?
Oh my God!
Come on.
As far as my eye can see, I can see chickens. My God!
It's a good job I'm not frightened of birds. I've just stepped into the middle of 25,000 of them.
So is this sort of like the legal maximum of birds that you're allowed to have in a space
No. We can grow chicken to a lot denser volume on the floor than this.
Denser than this?
Oh, yes. This is what I'm happy with.
There's more room for them to move around. And I'm personally just happier growing to 34 kilos a metre than the 38 kilos a metre that we're allowed.
But not everyone can afford to be as scrupulous as Alan Simpson.
Unfortunately, in our industry, there's a lot of people put these nice new buildings up. They've got to pay their loans back, and they can't afford to grow them like this. And there's a fine line between them having their own space and having very little space. And a lot of my colleagues believe that they would all grow chicken like this if only they could get a just return for it.
As chicken gets cheaper, turnover grows. Alan Simpson now has up to 250,000 birds in the sheds at any one time.
There's been a demand for cheap food, and then you get in the situation where they find out that, oh well, they can now produce it for a little bit less, and you get driven down. The price just gets driven down.
This is a hell of a lot of chickens. When I go into my supermarket, I pay, say, an average of £3 maybe for a chicken. Somebody's making a fortune.
The baby chick is about 26p. The food that we feed it is 64p. Your ongoings, heat, wages and all the other bits and pieces are about 16. Your processor probably works on about 50 pence a kilo. That leaves us with 4p. With 4p.
So you personally make 4 pence per chicken?
Yeah, it's a meagre amount for what we have invested here.
With farmers turning over millions of birds every year at just 4 pence a bird, it's vital to ensure that standards are kept high. So 5 years ago, the supermarkets and the poultry industry got together to launch the Assured Chicken Production Standards Scheme. Inspectors are supposed to make regular farm visits, even if they're pre-arranged. And if this red tractor logo is on a chicken on the supermarket shelves, it should mean that conditions in the broiler house have reached the proper standard. And this is all the more important because modern intensive farming techniques have turned chicken rearing into an industrial process. These chicks are a breed called Ross 308. Sounds like a sports car, but in fact it's the supermarket's favourite chicken because it fattens up fast. If you're eating chicken from a supermarket this evening, chances are it'll be a Ross 308. Once these baby chicks start tucking into their specially developed high-protein feed, a modern broiler farm can grow a chick from this to this in just 42 days. And that means that these little chicks will fast forward through life, reaching maturity in just about half the time it took their 1950s forebears. But what does all that do for the taste of supermarket chicken? Bland is about the best you can say, really. But that's a problem that doesn't just go for chicken. How does supermarket meat stand up against the traditional butcher? Chadwick's in Wigan is as traditional as they come. It's an old-fashioned high street butcher's where meat has been prepared the same way for decades. The kind of place the supermarkets have been putting out of business.
I believe that we should produce good food to the best of our knowledge for the benefit of our customer. I pay the farmers as much as I can. I charge the customers as little as I can. And in between, I try to make as much money as I can. But we will not sell anything that we don't think's fit.
So what does John Chadwick think of the kind of meat on sale in the supermarkets? We asked him to cast an expert eye over a selection of packaged meat we bought in his local supermarkets.
Right, what else have we got? New Seasons lamb, yeah, no problems with that. In there, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 loin chops and 2 cutlet chops pretending to be loin chops. Oh, that's well out of order.
Cutlets passing themselves off as loin chops. Shame on you, Asda. Whatever next? Asda told us one man's cutlet is another man's loin chop. Our loin chop packs, they said, include loin chops from the rib end, also known as cutlets. The National Federation of Meat and Food Traders disagree. Their spokesman told us a traditional loin chop should have a T-bone in it, unlike a cutlet.
All right, let's move on. We've got two nice pork chops. Oh, it isn't. When I read the label, it's with added water for extra succulence. Why adulterate a natural product? What else has gone in with the water? If you read the small print, there's all sorts gone in it. Dry glucose syrup, stabilizers, and preservatives. Why? It's a natural product. It'll keep. I don't understand.
And with a pack price of £2.20, you're paying 25 pence for all that water, glucose, stabilizers, and preservatives. According to Tesco, because customers now prefer grilling to frying, a brine solution is added to some pork cuts, because otherwise they would lose some succulence.
We've got another one. Oh, it's a cracker, this one. We've got the natural fat there, and we've got some added fat there. That means you've got animals from more than one beast. Bad butchery. If I look at mine, all I have is natural fat. If you buy mine, you buy more meat, less fat. In price, I'm actually a little bit cheaper, about 20 pence a kilo cheaper.
Tesco told us.
Added fat produces a more succulent joint. We also sell joints without added fat.
So the supermarkets can't always beat the traditional butcher on price, but what about taste? We decided to put a range of supermarket meat to the taste test. And here's a place where exquisite taste and top quality ingredients are very much on the menu. Raymond Blanc's award-winning Le Manoir aux Quatre Saisons. We invited a bunch of average shoppers from the Oxford area to join us there. And like most of the rest of us, they now do the bulk of their shopping in supermarkets.
Tesco's and Sainsbury's, they're the local ones.
Asda for cheapness.
I can sort of walk 5 minutes down my road and there's a Sainsbury's local.
Today they've volunteered to help us with our tasting. Sadly though, it won't be the confit of foie gras with soused cherries and spiced mango chutney. No, they're here to see if they can tell the difference between lamb and steak bought in a supermarket and the same meat bought from Raymond Blanc's favourite butcher.
So what do you have for me? That one is a Devonshire or Suffolk?
Yeah, Devonshire, that
lovely.
The texture on them is nice and soft.
Yeah.
But first, our jury of 12 are about to pass judgment on two sirloin steaks. They'll have nothing to go on but texture and taste. Yeah, sort of eyes lighting up there. Mm-hmm. And to make life more difficult, they've both been cooked by the man himself. The two different types are one that's from the supermarket and then the other one bought from the sort of traditional butchers. They don't know which is which, but it's the butcher's sirloin up first.
Meat number one, traditional butcher's prime sirloin.
I really like that, actually.
Lovely smell, really firm texture.
Juicy. Very nice.
I thought it was very juicy, which I thought was very good. Got a lot of taste straight off.
Okay, great. Well, and now it's the supermarket steak.
Here we go.
You always get to go first. You're very lucky, yeah. Aren't you?
Meat number two, Morrison's top quality sirloin steak.
The first one was more uniform. This is a bit messy in the way.
But it had quite a sort of buttery flavour, but it still wasn't as pleasing as the first one.
So, first of all, who preferred sirloin steak number one? Wow, this looks like a clear-cut verdict.
Oh, okay, 10. And ten. Who preferred steak number two?
Not looking good for Morrison's. So this looks like first blood to Monsieur Blanc. In fact, it's a 10-2 verdict in favour of the butcher's beef and against the supermarket sirloin.
Thank you, team.
You've made him very happy.
Next, it's lamb. And this time, we'll make it just a little more difficult.
Blindfolds on, everyone. Thank you very much.
Very serious.
They've got to do the job on taste alone. No clues from what it looks like this time.
And also, just to make the point that in all of the stuff that we've been buying, when we've been to the supermarkets, we've bought, you know, pretty much the best stuff that they have on offer. We've not sort of gone for the economy range of things, just so that you know that. We'll start from this end.
Meat number one, Sainsbury's lamb chops.
Okay, and if we could bring in lamb chop number two.
Meat number two, traditional butcher's lamb chops.
And who preferred lamb chop number two?
Not quite unanimous, but another comfortable victory for the traditional butcher.
Well, thank you very much, everyone. We're going to take a bit of a break now, and guess what? You can have something to eat.
A food tasting with Raymond Blanc is a pleasant way to find out about supermarket food. But in part two, I come face to face with the dark side of the meat industry. This is a chicken farm in Norfolk. Birds are reared here for one of the biggest suppliers of chickens to supermarkets across the country. Behind these doors are thousands of chickens. They've almost reached the end of their life cycle when they'll be slaughtered ready for eating. The conditions you are about to see are truly horrific. This film, shot by an undercover investigator just 2 months ago in May, is a chilling record of the way in which some chickens are being reared. Lameness is obvious. Birds unable to lift themselves out of the ammonia-soaked litter. But in amongst them, dead and injured birds, their companions sometimes trampling on them.
It's absolutely boiling in here, stifling in here.
The condition of some of these birds, badly injured but still alive, is deeply distressing. Yet many of them are likely simply to be slaughtered along with the rest. They won't make grade A, the whole chickens you find on the supermarket shelves, but when it comes to chicken pieces, the requirements are less demanding. We decided to show this film to Don Broome. He's Professor of Animal Welfare at Cambridge University.
What we see here is a bird which is splayed legs and is not able to stand up very well. Every farmer should manage their bird so that no bird is in that situation where it can't walk and is liable to be trampled on.
And one's just lost the will to live. Look, it's just sitting there. It can't move. It can't go anywhere.
Well, that bird is in extremis. The welfare would be very poor indeed. It can't control what's happening to it. And really, it needs to be taken out of that environment and probably killed.
But that's clearly not happening because that bird hasn't become like that, has it?
No, that's right.
Someone's not picking them out during the day.
No, there would have been a period of several days to get to that point.
See, let's just have a look. Now, that one at first sight looks like it's dead, but then if you look closely just there at the back, it's still moving.
Yes, it is.
Now, that to me looks like suffering. This is appalling. Now look, this is clearly dead.
Yes, that's a bird which has probably been unable to walk and then has been trampled on by the others. And we're actually treating these chickens in a different way from the way we would treat a cow or a horse. We wouldn't do this to a cow or a horse, leave them there to be trampled to death. And it does happen to chickens, and clearly the welfare of the birds is very poor when that does happen. Well, if the bird is prevented from walking, then it's not going to be able to get to water. And indeed food, but it would die from dehydration within a few days. So a bird which can't walk is going to die. But the other aspect of that is that if it can't walk, there's a real risk of being walked on by the other birds which are there. In other words, it's trampled to death.
I buy and eat a lot of chicken, and I'd think twice about it now after seeing this.
Outside the chicken sheds, the charmingly named dead bins.
I've got to show you inside this dead bin in a minute. I've just looked in here and you're not going to believe what's inside it.
I mean, this is utterly, utterly repulsive. Look, it's crawling with maggots, and you can't tell me this is following guidelines.
No, of course, what they're supposed to do is to get rid of these birds, take them away from the place where they might be passing on infection to the living birds.
How long is it before maggots appear when something's thrown in?
Probably 4 or 5 days.
So those have been in there for 4 or 5 days. Where should they be? Surely it shouldn't be allowed to get to that.
They could be put into a freezer, or they could be taken to a proper disposal place. You can actually tell how long exactly they've been there by looking at the developmental stage of those maggots.
And is that not grounds for prosecution?
Not for the welfare of those birds, but it would contravene the codes of practice not to take these birds away, because it will put the other birds at risk.
But I mean, the smell must be appalling.
Dead bins like this are a frightening example of how bad things can get. But according to Professor Broom, the conditions inside these sheds are anything but rare.
Well, what we're seeing here is a chicken production unit which is not atypical. Most of the birds are walking around, a few of them are severely affected. This isn't very different from what happens in other chicken production units.
So this is the reality of the chickens that we see on our supermarket shelves?
Yes, it is. Yes, these are the conditions in which the birds live.
Ironically, on the office wall, an out-of-date certificate shows that 4 years ago, this farm satisfied the requirements of the Assured Chicken Production Standards for chicken for human consumption. So who's responsible for these appalling conditions? Alongside that certificate are a number of documents showing that this farm supplies chickens to Grampian Country Foods. Their chickens are on the shelves of all Britain's big four supermarkets. We asked Grampian if they were aware of these conditions and what they were doing about it.
Grampian Country Food Group takes the welfare of its chicken flocks very seriously. All of our farms are independently audited by Assured Chicken Production to ensure that they meet all the current regulations and legislation covering chicken welfare. We are confident that our welfare policies and procedures continue to be in place on the farm in question, and cannot make any further comment on the allegations being made without viewing the footage.
You would hope that conditions like these are rare, but Professor Broom says that the state of the birds here is symptomatic of more widespread problems.
What we've done in breeding chickens for meat production over the last 30 or 40 years is to cause them to develop faster and faster. So birds actually are reaching a weight of 2 kilograms in 35 to 40 days now, whereas 30 years ago it would have been 75 to 80 days. Therefore the leg development hasn't kept pace with the body development. So we have a situation where a bird has legs of a 5-week-old bird and essentially the body of a 12 or 15 week old bird, and they can't support that body very well. And the consequence of it is that you have damage to the tissue, which means there's pain in the joints, and overall the bird is not able to stand up and walk around as it needs to do.
Back in his kitchen, Raymond Blanc is ideally qualified to perform a chicken autopsy.
To me, this chicken represents, if we can call it a chicken, represents all the ills of the food chains. How can you buy a £2.15 chicken? That chicken has the worst possible life. Look at that, it's totally unnatural to have that kind of thickness of breast. I don't want to touch it. I have to touch it today. But okay, let's take it out of his misery, poor little beast. I want to show you a few things, okay? Look at that. The older bone is very spongy. There's no calcium whatsoever. Of course, because that chicken has been grown between 40 and 50 days. That chicken, 120 days. Okay? Look how thick the legs are. Why? Because that chicken has never run in his life. Because poor little chap, okay? Fed, so it goes as fast as possible and as big as possible. Never mind the taste, never mind the texture, because it's an irrelevance. Okay, so you can see here, look the difference. Okay, all that is spongy, full of blood. Okay, the bone is very brittle. Okay, you can see it here. It breaks very quickly, very brittle. Look at that. Okay, it's not bone. Okay, it is sponge. Okay, so and that one. Okay, so look at the structure of that bone. Okay, look how opaque it is, how healthy it is, how strong it is. But of course, that chicken has run, had lots of sex, lots of food from the ground, okay, had a very happy life. So obviously it's a very different chicken, and of course that will translate into the flavor as well. Look at that. Although the chicken, look at the color of that meat. Look at the color. Immediately you can see, okay, the color is so different.
So, want to make sure you don't buy one of those chickens that can't support their own weight? Well, I've got a clue for you, one that we can all look out for in the supermarket. Something that tells us about the conditions in which a chicken has been reared. It's called a hock burn.
A hock burn is a form of dermatitis which affects the layers of skin on a chicken, and it is something which is caused by the ammonia which is in the litter that the birds will be sitting on or crouching on. And ammonia burns skin, and that will affect several layers of skin and may be followed by ulceration. And that would be painful to the chickens because they have pain receptors in the skin, just as we do.
But just how many of these lame, overgrown chickens are making it into the supermarkets?
The study which Nadine Reifman and I carried out in Cambridge involved going to 11 different supermarkets and looking at 384 birds. And what we found was that 82% of the birds had some degree of hock burn, and these levels were rather a lot higher than we'd thought.
Don Broom's study has just been published. It's a shocking indictment of the industry, but it's based on chickens bought some time ago. We wanted to check for ourselves that they were on sale right now in supermarkets. So Professor Broom agreed to go on a hock burn hunt, this time with a secret camera following his movements. Professor Broom went shopping in the Cambridge branch of each of the big four supermarkets. It wasn't long before he found the first chicken with a hock burn, a telltale brown mark on the rounded, scaly part of the leg.
An obvious hock burn there. More on one leg than the other.
And as he continued his buying spree, Professor Broom had no trouble finding them. They were in every supermarket he went to.
The damage to the tissue in a hock burn of this size would go down several millimetres into the tissue, so that would be quite painful, something like that.
He even found chickens where the hock burn had been carefully removed before the bird was packed.
You can see the hock burn area, even though the scales have been removed there. You can see that the tissue underneath the scales is damaged by the hock burn.
After several hours of intense shopping, Professor Broom had struck unlucky in all of the big four supermarkets.
On this bird here, this is a fairly severe hock burn, at least for a grade A chicken. Now on this bird you can see that there is a small area of hock burn there, a medium size there, and then there's an area where the scales are missing. There might well have been a more extensive hock burn there.
And then on this bird here, you can see the tail end, the parson's nose, has a lot of red coloration on it. That area there would be the result of contact with the litter and some sort of friction on the litter for this bird during the time that it's in the house. I think people don't realise that they actually can just look at the bird in the supermarket and they can see these brown marks on the legs. Anybody can do this and can decide whether or not to purchase the bird.
The Supermarkets Trade Association, the British Retail Consortium, told us...
Supermarkets take the issue of animal welfare extremely seriously, and it is a fundamental requirement of their suppliers.
They added that animal welfare is...
controlled through strict production standards, one of which is assured chicken production. Any breaches in these standards are unacceptable and are always taken up with the producer.
This chick has a disease called coccidiosis. It's a bacterial infection of the gut, which can sweep through a flock of chickens in no time. It causes loss of appetite and diarrhea. Birds with coccidiosis pass droppings containing tiny little spores called oocysts. And if, in the cramped conditions of the broiler house, birds start to peck at those droppings, the whole flock can soon be infected. But responsible chicken farmers like Alan Simpson take preventative measures by giving the birds feed containing special drugs called coccidiostats. They've been doing it for years. Trouble is, not much is known about the effect of coccidiostats on people. So, to be safe, farmers are required to withdraw them from the birds' feed several days before slaughter. But organic farming pressure group, the Soil Association, are worried that there may be some left when they're plucked, filleted, and whisked off to the shelves. We decided to put the supermarket's cheap chicken to the test. We went to all four major supermarkets and brought frozen chickens in each, and some chicken livers too, because that's where the coccidiostats are most likely to be found. We sent them to a top research lab in Germany to be tested for any sign of coccidiostat residue. This is what they found. There were traces in 37 of our 40 supermarket samples. No problem there, though, because the amounts we found are well within the government's acceptable limit of 200 micrograms per kilogram of meat. But all our chickens had the same coccidiostat in them. It's called nicarbazin, and it's the subject of a bit of a Euro scrap. Dr. Vivian Howard is one of the country's leading toxicologists.
With respect to nicarbazin, this has been looked at by the EU in their FEDAP committee. And once again, they've come up with a report which says there isn't enough information there for them to make a decision about the mutagenicity. So that's the ability of this medicine or drug to actually cause damage to DNA. And so they, in the absence of that information, they are saying that they can't set a maximum residue level.
In other words, they can't decide whether nicarbazin is definitely safe at any level. And what that means is that whilst here in the UK, the residue levels we found were well within the government's acceptable limits, some experts think there's good reason to be extra careful.
I think we can be fairly certain that if you're eating chicken from broiler houses, you will be getting a level of exposure to this compound. Now, of course, the regulators will say, but it's underneath the maximum residue level, therefore it's safe. But I think that particularly with respect to infants and the fetus, we should be minimising exposure.
Now, it's not just me, is it? These bigger, grow-faster chickens do seem to produce an awful lot of fat when they're cooked in the pan. So is the modern way of eating breeding not just obese children, but obese chickens too? Well, there's only one way to find out. Liposuction. This is the Institute of Brain Chemistry and Human Nutrition at London Metropolitan University. We've brought along a chicken from each of the big four supermarkets, Tesco, Sainsbury's, Morrison's and Asda, so the boffins here can find out what they're made of. They're going to start by extracting all the fat to see if these cheap chickens are just obese couch potatoes. First step, into the blender. The necessary chemicals are standing by. The whole chicken has to be reduced to a pink goo. Then add some solvent and the long process of extracting the fat is underway. A week later, the tests are all complete and I'm back at the Institute to meet with Michael Crawford. No, not that one. Dr. Michael Crawford. He's the man who supervised the tests for us, and apparently he's got some startling results.
Well, this is the fat out of one single chicken, and that was about 17% fat.
That's almost a pint of fat from one chicken.
I'm horrified by this.
Basically, they were all the same.
I eat a lot of chicken.
Right.
Because I think it's low in fat.
Well, it isn't.
And that's
just out of one chicken. I mean, what effectively you're getting here, the big problem is that you're getting, in terms of the calorie value, more calories coming from fat than protein. And what this means is that the public thinks they're buying a protein-rich food. In fact, they're buying a fat-rich food. In 1976, the Royal College of Physicians, British Cardiac Society, said in their report on coronary heart disease, if you want to avoid heart disease, eat less fatty red meat and choose chicken because it's low in fat.
And that's
stuck. And it used to be the case.
It was the case that
chickens provided more protein than fat. Now it's the other way around.
Chickens didn't always used to have this much fat.
No, of course it didn't.
Did they?
Of course
so it why didn't. Do they now?
What happens is that if you feed the animal on a high energy diet, and if it doesn't get any exercise, it does put on weight, and the weight that it puts on, a large part of that is fat.
So this extra fatty chicken that we're all buying, I think we buy 850 million of them a year now. This extra fatty one has in a way been created by the demand of the supermarkets.
Yes.
They provide a very cheap form of protein for families that don't necessarily have a lot of money.
Yeah, and the problem is that exactly the people that you're talking about who don't have much money to spend on food, they're exactly the people who are now suffering from obesity, diabetes, heart disease and stroke.
But there's more bad news. Even the type of fat is wrong.
There are two families of essential fatty acids, both of which you need in a proper balance, the omega-6 and the omega-3. And because of the intensive rearing of animals, what has happened is that the balance between these two families has got completely out of sync. The omega-3 fatty acid that's important for the brain was in the 1970s knocking at the levels of about 170 milligrams per 100 grams of food. There's only 20 in these. So it's been sliced sevenfold. But the interesting thing is that people in the National Institutes of Health in the United States, Joe Hibble in particular, is now blaming the rise in mental ill health amongst young people on precisely the shift in the ratio of the balance between these fatty acids.
So cheap chicken is fatter than it used to be, but the British Retail Consortium insist that
chicken meat remains a nutritious part of the British diet and complies with all UK and European regulations.
At least roast chicken isn't in a box, yet more and more of what we're being sold these days is just that. Over the last decade or so, it's the aisle that's grown like a broiler bird. Welcome to the world of the supermarket ready meal.
That, to me, that's a crime against humanity.
You can't help
noticing that the supermarket shelves are increasingly full of pre-cooked this, partially roasted that, generally complete meals that you can just pop into your oven or microwave, and hey presto. Yes, the ready meal is taking over the aisles. Mission Control at one of the most successful ready meal companies in the world. You'll find their curries in supermarkets up and down the high street. And this is Sir Ghulam Noon. Churning out ready meals has lifted him into the Sunday Times rich list. He's made 50 million from them. But according to him, the person who really benefits is the harassed housewife.
It has actually broken the shackles of the housewife from the kitchen. The housewife can go to work, and now today, and most important thing is that it is a safe product to eat.
This is food as industrial process. High quality ingredients, additive free, and all the latest machinery.
Any factories which produces the ready meals in this country, the factories are brilliant. In terms of the microbiologies are checked, and the super services, super machinery, etc. And they are absolutely not only delicious, but they are safe to eat. Because it is, the ready meals are actually made in the environment, which is a unique environment nowadays. It's completely aseptic factories are there.
Noons were one of the first out of the blocks, but pretty soon all the supermarkets were onto the ready meals bandwagon themselves. But more doesn't necessarily mean better.
When you look at the label on the back of a ready meal, the vast majority of them are made with what's cheapest for manufacturers to use.
And the quality is often really poor. You're paying for extra additives, you're paying for added water, huge amounts of sugar and salt.
Lamb casserole will have kind of 10 different types of sugar on the back. Well, what's that doing there? It's because they're not real ingredients giving real flavour.
But that is added value food, and that's very profitable for them.
I'd really rather not eat them.
It's a market that's grown by more than 60% in the last 10 years or so, almost as much as the claims for their products. Take this Sainsbury's Taste the Difference Moroccan chicken with apricots and pine nuts.
Pairing sweet fruit with spices in the time-honoured Moroccan style gives this dish the exotic, warming flavours of a tagine.
I think supermarkets in Britain have really grown by exploiting the gap, that knowledge gap between the food producer and the consumer. And that's where they've made their money. And they've succeeded because we know so little about food, we don't know any better. So if someone says to us something that is blatantly ridiculous, like, here is a ready meal that was cooked in a factory and trucked all around Britain, and it tastes much better than anything that you could cook at home. We actually believe that. Now, most Europeans would say, come off it, you've got to be joking. It won't. It can't.
We asked Raymond Blanc to try a typical supermarket ready meal, bœuf bourguignon from Asda.
Voilà. Okay, that bœuf bourguignon has got a very, very strong colour. Let's have a smell of it. Yeah, you go for it. Oh my God.
Very intense.
That to me, that's a crime against humanity. It's a crime against food. When I came in the 70s in England, yes, that's what I would eat. But now, you don't expect. Oh, it's horrendous. It's absolutely, it's jammy, it's messy, it's chemical. You can feel the chemicals right the way through, you know? It's, wow.
Just take one each. So Raymond would clearly have no problem spotting a ready meal, but would our average shoppers be able to?
It's done food, only.
After a little persuasion, he agreed to knock up a bœuf bourguignon of his own to see if they could tell the difference.
Now I'm going to mix those two together. Wow, look at that. Then the one, wow.
Well, Raymond's obviously very keen on healthy ingredients, and so are the supermarkets, because their product planners have discovered that health sells. Combine convenience and health in the same packet, and you've got a supermarket Shangri-La. And now they're all over the place. Healthy living, be good to yourself, eat smart, good for you. Each of the big four has its healthy, ready meal range. But just how good for you are they? We asked Staffordshire Trading Standards to check out some of the claims.
In most cases, the healthier option type styled product did contain less fat than the standard product, and that's a good thing, and that's what we'd expect. But in some cases, it would contain the same amount of fat as the standard product, and in one or two cases, it actually contained more.
Take these chicken dippers from Sainsbury's Blue Parrot range for children. They actually have more fat per 100 grams than the equivalent adult product. And this good-for-you lasagna from Asda has less fat than Asda's ordinary lasagna. But that's because it's got less meat. It's just 14% meat instead of 23%. That's one way of cutting down your fat intake, I suppose. These healthy meals seem to have plenty of helpful nutritional information on the packets, but you need to know what it all means. Take salt, for example.
It's not universally true that if you buy a healthy option meal, you necessarily get a reduced salt meal. We have here a healthy living jambalaya, which claims to be 3% fat, 477 calories, which on analysis found to be true. If you look at the back of the label for the full information, it points out that a serving of this product would give me the 477 calories, but would also give me 3.8 grams of salt. So if I, as a woman with a need of 2,000 calories a day and targeted not to eat more than 6 grams of salt a day at this, I would get a quarter of my daily amount of calories, but three quarters of the recommended amount of salt that I could eat in a day.
Back in the kitchen, Raymond's bœuf bourguignon is ready for the tasters. Will they spot which is which? I'm going to bring Raymond in.
Yes, okay. I don't fall. I've worked 25 years to get to
be a grown man cry.
Can we look at the sweat, please? Can we look at the sweat here? Let me just ask you, first of all, any sort of thoughts and observations on what you tasted?
The first one was very intense. The second one, it was just lighter and cleaner tasting.
It's more depth to the flavours in it, maybe.
OK, well, so you're ready for this, Raymond?
Oh, completely. Yeah.
I expect always the worst.
Who preferred dish number one? Who preferred dish number two?
Well done, guys, well done.
I don't think I need to tell you the answer, do I? A very relieved and happy
Not man. Really relieved.
Asda versus Raymond Blanc, no contest. But can I persuade him to come to my kitchen to cook it? Next week on Supermarket Secrets, ducks in distress. Why the Spanish prefer ugly tomatoes. And the dairy cows bred to produce up to 120 pints of milk every day.
Monday night at 8 for part 2 of this Dispatches special. Well, next up, an ambassador's ball and a double-crossing secret agent, very 007, in an extended Big Brother.
Our children's food to be nutritious and unadulterated by chemicals.
Yay, good tomatoes, aren't they?
They know that we care about the environment and we're against waste. And they know that we want animals to be reared and killed humanely. There are millions of us that think like this, and the supermarkets want to convince us that they give us exactly what we want. But do they? We'll be right back.
50 years ago, we bought all our food from specialist high street shops. We knew our shopkeepers, and they knew us, even if the greengrocer still passed off the occasional rotten apple. Even our milk and bread was delivered daily by the local dairy. But back in the 1950s, shopping started to change.
The supermarket and the self-service centre have come to stay. Already, there are over 4,000 in Britain.
It was the start of a retailing revolution. Today, the big four, Tesco, Sainsbury's, Asda and Morrisons, dominate UK food production and food retailing. And they persuade us they're giving us what we want by using health-conscious celebrities like Jamie Oliver.
The British asparagus season's pretty short, so make the most of it. And Sainsbury's get them into store really quickly, so you don't lose any of that fantastic flavour. Easy.
The supermarkets do such amazing monitoring of what customers are thinking or asking. They do tracking surveys, all of them. Go and ask them. They all do tracking surveys. They don't release them, but they'll track what consumers are thinking on 30, 40, 50 different criteria about food.
And tracking surveys aren't the only thing they keep under wraps. Despite repeated requests for cooperation, none of the big four would allow us to film inside their stores. Are there things they'd rather we didn't know? Factory farming is a big issue for some consumers, and that's a commercial opportunity for the supermarkets. Now they can sell us more and more free-range organic poultry, even if it does cost more. Tonight, we thought we'd try duck, just for a change. But believe me, it's not the cheap option. These four duck breasts from Asda cost £8.40. And before making this programme, it never really occurred to me that ducks might be factory farmed too. From what I've learned, I'm beginning to doubt my choice. Ducks enjoying their natural habitat. Swimming is part of their genetic makeup, and in the wild they spend up to 80% of their time in water. These ducks had a lucky escape. As ducklings, they were liberated from a Norfolk factory farm. Now they live here at the Hillside Animal Sanctuary near Norwich. Thousands of other birds were not so fortunate. Buried away in the Norfolk countryside lies this anonymous-looking poultry farm. It's owned by Kerry Foods. They supply duck to many British supermarkets, including the Big Four, and the market for duck is growing fast. In February 2003, investigators from Hillside Animal Sanctuary secretly shot this footage. This is a Kerry Foods packaging plant. The duck farm is just down the road. Inside the broiler shed, there were dead and suffering ducks.
This is the third dead duck. Duck number six is over here. Duck number seven is over here. Another duck on its back here.
At the time, the farm was accredited by the RSPCA's Freedom Food Scheme. This means it had been assessed to see if it met strict animal welfare standards. One is that livestock should have freedom to express normal behaviour. But here, as in the vast majority of British intensive duck farms, there's no water for swimming.
If you're setting standards for the keeping of ducks, then one of the conditions should be that the birds have access to an area of water in which they can swim. All ducks ought to be provided with water in which they can swim. And if you don't do that, then you're not caring for them adequately.
Duck number 14, I haven't seen him.
The RSPCA's Freedom Food Scheme also says livestock should have freedom from pain, injury and disease. Yet some of these birds are suffering from septicemia, a bacterial stress-related condition.
Septicemia can come on over a period of a few days, And clearly some of those birds were in a rather extreme state where they would have been suffering a lot from the disease.
Outbreaks of disease are commonplace in intensive poultry farms. Under the government code of practice, the birds should be systematically checked at least twice each day.
Those checks really need to be sufficient to pick out the bird which is in a bad way, the bird which needs to be taken out or the bird which needs to be humanely killed.
As soon as they discovered that the farm was accredited by the Freedom Food Scheme, Hillside investigators alerted the RSPCA. They immediately suspended the farm from their scheme, and Kerry Foods were prosecuted for causing unnecessary suffering to ducks. In their defence, Kerry Foods denied the charges in their entirety, maintaining that the birds had been properly checked by an experienced stockman. But because the footage had been obtained by trespass, the judge never saw this film, and she concluded,
"There can be no doubt that this company did have the birds' welfare in mind."
And Kerry Foods were found not guilty. So, did things improve at the Kerry Foods farm? Last July, investigators from Viva, another animal welfare group, secretly filmed there too.
Here we've got two dead birds near a feeder. Got another duck here, looks like it's trapped. Been here for a while. This duck hasn't looked too well. This bird is dying.
In the later visits, there were still birds which were sick. There were birds which may well have had the same disease condition, and there were quite a lot of birds which died. You would expect there to be some birds which die, but it would appear that there's still quite a significant problem if there were quite a few birds which were dead or dying on any given day when a visit was made.
We wrote to Kerry Foods about the conditions on their farm, and they gave us this statement.
The farm operates to the highest industry standards, and the company's trained stockmen and veterinarians uphold the highest husbandry and industry standards.
As Kerry Foods supply duck to all the Big Four, we also asked the Supermarkets Trade Association, the British Retail Consortium, to comment on the welfare concerns raised by the undercover footage. They said,
"Supermarkets take the issue of animal welfare very seriously. It is a fundamental requirement of their suppliers. Any breaches in these standards are unacceptable and are always taken up with the producer."
I know that there are supermarket standards. Clearly, these should be enforced in such a way that we, first of all, make sure that the basic conditions are good enough and the needs are met, and secondly, that if there is a disease condition, that it's dealt with in a proper way so that there is a minimal amount of poor welfare in the animals.
And in case you're wondering, the RSPCA tells us that there are currently no British duck farms with Freedom Food accreditation. Big come on, rows and rows of perfectly presented fruit and vegetables, a glistening array designed to entice us through the doors. And it's always the first aisle you come to.
Supermarket buyers have become obsessed with cosmetic standards.
You walk into the store and you think, wow, this is lovely, lovely fresh fruits and vegetables. It creates a good impression, like flowers do.
We're presented with everything absolutely homogenous, perfect, uniform, so that it looks as though it's emerged from a lab. To be honest, it doesn't look normal.
You think, this is a nice place to shop. And it creates the idea that everything under the roof is fresh and wholesome and delicious.
But how does our food get to look that good? The answer lies in places like this.
It's got to be perfect. It's got to be worth it to me.
This is a supermarket packing house. Every day, a ruthless beauty contest roots out the less than perfect, even for your common or garden spud.
after a quick scrub up the first hurdle. Size matters. Too small and they just fall through the holes. Next, it's shape. Any shape you like, as long as it's oval. For those that make it through, it's time to face the cameras. Anything with a blemished skin will be weeded out. In the end, only the best-looking potatoes make it. Just like life, really. And spuds are not alone. Every day, as much as 30% of perfectly edible produce will be rejected at supermarket packing sheds, just on the basis of appearance. Supermarket waste is not confined to Britain. We've managed to export it.
I've been to parts of the world where people are actually hungry, like Africa, where women are standing in huts measuring green beans because they're only allowed to be a very specific length and a very specific diameter. And anything that doesn't fit that absolutely perfect, straight blueprint gets chucked away. So it's been like a third of the beans in Kenya that I was watching being harvested were being thrown away, going to waste, because they didn't meet this extraordinary specification.
And supermarket specifications are indeed extraordinary. Earlier this year, The Guardian obtained one for cucumbers. According to the report, they must be between 10 and 13 inches long, must be evenly swollen along the length, and they must not have droop. And as for bulbous ends, well, they're simply not acceptable. And it's the same story with apples. This Kent farm supplies fruit to many of the big supermarkets. Today, the farm's apple sorting machine is grading cooking apples according to the supermarket's specifications. As usual, it's size, shape, colour and general appearance.
The standards for cooking apples are not as high as they are for eating apples. That's a defect there and there. And it's picking up probably some bruising on this one there, and then some other defects as well. It's got to be.
The Griefer machine was developed from Israeli fighter aircraft technology, and even cooking apples get supermodel treatment. Each and every one is photographed by computerised infrared cameras.
The magic box behind this computer is taking 72 pictures of every apple, and what's coming up on the screen is all the defects that we've told it to learn. So it is a very, very clever bit of kit.
Clive Baxter reckons he loses about one-third of his crop because supermarket specifications are so rigid. But the supermarkets insist they do everything possible to reduce waste.
What they mean is no waste outside their backyard. The waste is happening elsewhere. When they reject a field of cauliflowers for having a bit of cosmetic damage to it or not being the right size, or reject apples for not being the right size, or the look, or a bit of blemish. What does the farmer do with that? Eat it? They can't, they're fields. Throw it away? That's what happens. So there's hidden waste.
But is this hidden waste the consumer's fault? The supermarkets say they have to reject produce because we refuse to buy anything that's less than perfect.
I don't think consumers are driving this one bit. I don't think we've ever said, no, we must all have identical fruit. I don't think women go home at night in tears and say, my oranges are not identical.
The supermarkets can be sometimes falsely criticised for having created this cosmetically pretty-looking food, as though somehow consumers didn't demand that. Supermarkets, for example, did listen to consumers saying they didn't want earwigs coming out of cauliflowers, apples that had cracks in them. The problem is the hurdle has been set so high, inappropriately high, and it's now in a vicious circle of repeating itself.
So how do farmers achieve the exacting standards demanded by their supermarket customers? The answer is pesticides.
If you want pears that have got absolutely no blemishes on the skin. The farmer is going to have to use certain types of chemicals at certain points in the year to make sure that happens. And the legacy of that is obviously that we end up with residues in our food. I've talked to farmers who say, if I've got one aphid on my lettuce, my whole crate will be rejected. So, of course, I double the amount of spray I use to make sure there's absolutely no life left on it.
The supermarkets know that consumers worry about pesticide residues and claim they go to great lengths to encourage suppliers to minimise pesticides use.
Supermarkets love to get good PR out of trumpeting how they're reducing pesticides. But at one level they're saying, no, we're telling our growers to reduce pesticides. On the other side, they're delivering ridiculously tight standards, which any professional grower could tell you means you must use quite a substantial number of pesticides. So I think that it is totally hypocritical, the supermarket stance on pesticides. It just doesn't add up.
Government checks show that 30% of supermarket fresh fruit and vegetables do contain some pesticide residues. These are within the legal limits, but we've discovered something of potential concern to parents of babies and toddlers. Back in 1999, the EU issued a directive which massively reduced the amounts of pesticide residues allowed in processed baby foods to just 10 parts per billion.
The reason why the very low level has been imposed for prepared baby foods is on a precautionary basis, because children who are developing their brains, their immune system, their reproductive system are more vulnerable to the effect of things like hormone disruption.
This is news to me, and it's worrying.
New mothers are advised by the NHS to wean their babies on fresh fruit and vegetables. So when I give Grace pureed fresh fruit, I assume it's better for her than what's in these bottled baby jars.
But maybe cosmetically perfect supermarket produce is not as pure as it looks.
OK, so that's the last of the big four, so I've stocked up on the kind of fruit and veg that mums commonly like to give their young children and babies. But I'm not going to take this lot home. I'm off to the lab.
This is Kent Scientific Services in Maidstone. We asked their analysts to use the government's own testing procedure to tell us how much pesticide residue was in our supermarket fruit and veg. In all, they tested 16 samples of produce, and they found pesticide residues in 7 of them. The good news is they were all under the government's limits. The bad news is they all exceeded the levels allowed in processed baby food. One sample contained 33 times as much. According to the government's Food Standards Agency, home-prepared baby foods could contain residues at a slightly higher level than would be found in manufactured foods. They maintain the risk is not significantly higher, but others disagree.
I think it is illogical that if you go and buy a prepared baby food, it's controlled by EU legislation, whereas if you go and buy fresh fruit from the supermarkets, they may well have levels of pesticide considerably higher. And that's an anomaly which I think the government has to address. We should be aiming for the same standard in fresh fruit, because we want to be able to feed our children fresh fruit. That's a very good thing to do.
In part two, more supermarket secrets. Buy one, get one free. Who pays? Factory farmed cows. And the bouncing strawberry. In recent years, as concern about pesticide residues has grown, supermarkets have been quick to jump on the organic bandwagon.
It's much harder to get things looking that kind of beauty pageant perfect that the supermarkets expect if you don't use pesticides. And the irony is that although supermarkets now stock quite a lot of fruit and vegetables that is organic, they really apply the same cosmetic standards. It has to look as perfect as the conventional stuff.
South Wales farmer Bruce Carlyle grows organic potatoes for supermarkets. These won't be harvested until the autumn. But this lot, 15% of last year's crop, has been left to rot. They didn't meet the supermarket specification, so Bruce didn't even bother to send them to the packing plant.
They would say, right, these are not good enough, take them back. That potato, which is actually a misshape, now that will get rejected as a misshape. That potato has got something which is called netting. It's a rough skin finish. Now that, to me, is a perfect potato to be consumed, but is rejected on skin finish. That's a potato which is a perfect potato to look at, except if you've got a blemish, a growth crack on the end. It could be bruising, but it'll peel off.
Of the potatoes Bruce did send to the supermarket packing plant, another 25% were rejected. The Soil Association says organic farmers commonly have 40% of their crop wasted, purely on cosmetic grounds. And guess who picks up the tab for all this waste? The supermarkets? Wrong. It's the farmer.
If our potatoes get rejected, that's our waste, that's our loss. You get used to wastage, which I don't think is right. You get used to seeing 26 loads of potatoes not thrown back in your face, but returned to you because they're not good enough. It's soul-destroying, you know, it just doesn't go with organic farming.
And with so much waste, it's little wonder organic produce costs a bomb.
If the supermarket standards weren't so tight and so cosmetically correct, we would be producing produce at a much lower cost to the consumer and much less wastage.
So the consumer loses out, the farmer loses out, but at least Bruce Carlyle's cows are benefiting. He's fed 100 tons of last year's crop to his cattle, and they don't seem to care how ugly the potatoes are. British farming is in deep trouble. First there was BSE, then foot and mouth. And now, with supermarkets dictating that food either looks good or gets chucked away, farmers are being squeezed till they squeak. And what's bad for them is bad for us too.
Sometimes I scratch what hair I've got left, and I say, do consumers really understand that food comes from farmers? But equally, sometimes I look at farming and think, what on earth are they doing? Why would anyone farm?
Supermarkets are now so powerful, they've emerged as these incredible oligopolies who can dictate the price they pay. And they've sort of wiped out any other outlets. There are no real wholesale markets where farmers can say, OK, if you're not going to pay me properly, I'll take my goods somewhere else, because somewhere else doesn't actually exist anymore.
And you see an extraordinary thing going on in British farming, the collapse of profitability in farming, the collapse of morale, the collapse in numbers of farming, while retailing rides on into the sunset.
Critics claim that supermarkets have Britain's farmers by the short and curlies. One example is the special promotions they use to entice us into their stores.
Tesco, buy one, get one free. It's simple. You buy one and get one free.
Everyone likes something for nothing, and this commercial appeals to the consumer's mercenary side.
Tesco, every little helps.
But it certainly doesn't help Clive Baxter.
We suffer quite a bit when they do their promotions, or when we're asked to do promotions with them, particularly the buy one, get one free. That hurts us very hard.
Now, how does that hurt you? Because if I go in, I'm a big fan of buy one, get one free. I always see things like that and buy it. But I always think that the supermarket's taking the hit for that. So that's not the case.
No, that's definitely not the case. Last year, because we were doing so much of the raspberries at half price or bog off, that cost me 50,000 pounds. And it is extremely difficult to run a business like that. And we just go from periods of euphoria to periods of despair.
It's not all negative. Clive says supermarkets have helped him become more efficient and produce better quality fruit. But he's totally dependent on them.
What worries me about our relationships with these very powerful people is that we are little ants underneath this great elephant, and we are going to get squashed.
While fruit farmers like Clive Baxter are worried, dairy farming is in crisis. Milk, one of the healthiest of all drinks. In supermarket jargon, it's a known value item. If the price is low, shoppers flock into the store. But the low price of milk has been disastrous for Britain's dairy farmers. In the last 3 years, 3,964 of them have gone to the wall. That's 25 every week. Many of them blame the supermarkets.
Perhaps the most obscene element of all is the supermarkets are prepared to charge as much as or twice as much for a bottle of fizzy water as they are for a bottle of milk. And we, the consumers, buy it.
And it's not just farmers who suffer. John Webster is Professor of Animal Husbandry at Bristol University, and he's worried. Modern dairy farming is becoming an intensive industry, and an increasing number of cows now spend most of their lives indoors. It's called zero grazing. This footage was shot by Compassion in World Farming at two intensive dairy farms in England. Instead of grass, the cows stand on concrete. And instead of grazing in meadows, they are fed mown grass indoors.
They don't have the satisfaction of grazing. They don't have the comfort of being at grass, of lying out in the sunshine or under the tree if it's shady. There's precious little joy in life left for the modern dairy cow. These are having quite a good time.
To produce maximum milk yields, modern dairy cows are pushed to their physiological limits through a combination of selective breeding and high-energy feeds. The impact on cows' welfare has been dramatic. Most supermarket milk is produced under the National Dairy Farm Assurance Scheme, which guarantees high standards of animal welfare. But although not evident at these farms, up to 40% of modern dairy cows suffer from mastitis, a painful inflammation of the udder, which can lead to diarrhea, dehydration, and death. And even more suffer from lameness, caused by standing in slurry.
Lameness in the dairy cow is my biggest worry, because national statistics show that in any one year about 50% of dairy cows are going to become lame, and at any one time over 20% of them are actually in pain from lameness, moderate to severe pain from lameness. Moreover, the pain goes on and on and on for weeks. Food from animals comes from sentient creatures who have the capacity to suffer and who deserve a good life. And that means that when we look for quality in the supermarket, we must build in quality of life for the animal as part of the criteria.
And consumers are losing out too. While supermarket milk is still an essential source of calcium, several recent studies indicate that organic milk is higher in other vital nutrients.
It's got more omega-3, and we're on average getting not even a third of what we should be having. It's got more vitamin E, which helps protect against aging. It's also got more beta-carotene and antioxidants, which protect against cancer and deterioration of the eyesight. It also tastes better, so it's more enjoyable, and actually it doesn't really cost a lot more. We're talking about a few pence difference to have something that is so good and more enjoyable.
So the next time you go to your local supermarket, spare a thought for the poor, overworked dairy cow and consider the quality of the milk you buy. The supermarkets say they have increased the range and diversity of our food, and that's undoubtedly true.
can eat Mexican, Chinese, you can have guacamole, you can have tortillas, whatever you want. British supermarkets give you it, and we mistake that with appreciating good food at a fundamental level. We don't.
They've turned themselves into cathedrals of choice. You walk past hundreds of meters of products, all demanding, calling for your attention, saying, buy me, eat me, consume me.
Today, supermarkets stock all sorts of exotic fruit and vegetables. Figs, mangoes, aubergines, virtually unavailable 30 years ago. Our own homegrown produce. This is the National Fruit Collection in Kent. You know, it's mystifying. There are more than 700 varieties of apple that are native to the British Isles. Just look at them all. And they've all got fantastic names, as things like Pitmarston, pineapple, green custard, bloody ploughman's, to name but three. Just imagine all that taste and texture, all that choice. So why is it when I go to the supermarket, even during the English apple season, all I see are the same old names? Most of us don't even know what we're missing. How many varieties of apples can you name?
I don't know. Bramley apple, Cox, Granny Smith. It's Golden Delicious one?
Yeah. One.
It's Granny Smith one?
Yep.
There's your Coxies. Is it Coxies Pippin? Your French Golden?
Golden Delicious, Granny Smith.
So why is our choice so limited? This huge depot is one of Sainsbury's regional distribution centres. All the big supermarkets have them, strategically placed around the country. The supermarkets claim to be introducing more local produce, but every day, fleets of lorries pound the motorways, delivering millions of tons of food to the stores.
They've got into this mess over 30 years, this huge, complex distribution system where you can buy food at your local supermarket, and it maybe originally was grown by a farmer 20 miles away, but it's trunked up and down motorways before it comes back to you. This is crazy ecological economics, but it happens.
The environmental and social cost of all these food miles is huge, £9 billion a year. It's been estimated that a typical Sunday lunch travels 26,234 miles. Some journeys simply beggar belief. One Scottish farmer told us that his entire crop of sprouts was taken from the field to a depot, then to an airport where it was flown to Poland to be trimmed and packed, then flown back to the UK and sent to various regional distribution centres. Some of them even ended up at the local supermarket just yards down the road from his farm. And it's the ability to withstand all this travelling and arrive in the supermarket looking perfect that determines what's available. Because some varieties simply get travel sick. Take strawberries, for example. Once a longed-for summertime treat, ripe, soft and dripping with juice, now they're available all year round. This is Perry Court Farm Shop in Kent.
Now, look, you don't see this in the supermarkets. Picked this morning.
No, well, exactly.
Can I eat one?
Of course you can.
Thank you.
Mmm. They do taste like... They taste like I remember strawberries tasted.
Yeah. Heidi and Martin Furmore used to supply the supermarkets with strawberries. Not anymore.
We grew, I think, about 10 varieties at the time. Two of them, which we thought were excellent strawberries, but they just didn't want to take them.
Why not?
I think that, they thought, I think at the time, El Santa was the one, and that's the only one they wanted.
In the trade, the El Santa is known as the strawberry that bounces.
So we have a Duff variety that has been picked immature. And this is why you have these big, crunchy red strawberries that last for quite a long time, surprisingly long time, but just have no flavour.
And it's become ubiquitous in British supermarkets.
El Santa. El Santa. Well, it doesn't specify what variety these are, but my guess, El Santa. El Santa.
So why is it that we British have such bland, tasteless food, but in Europe it's so scrumptious?
I've come to Madrid to find out from someone who really knows. The man who used to run Safeway is now over here in Spain in charge of one of the country's biggest supermarkets.
Carlos Criado Perez says we get the food we deserve.
So, Carlos, I mean, looking at this, what is the difference between what we're seeing here and what we would see in a British supermarket?
Well, I would say that the first thing that is a big difference is that you're seeing fruits and vegetables by the season. So you're not seeing the same product all through the year. In the UK, you would see a set standard all through the year. The bananas would be there the whole year, the grapes would be there the whole year. You're seeing also, they are not all sitting on the shelves and little soldiers looking all alike. They are much more varied in shape.
They're natural.
They're natural, yes. They have more natural.
Carlos told me that in Spain, supermarket shoppers just won't buy grapes when they're out of season. And the varieties they just won't buy, the Spanish export to us.
Tastes different.
The good number of the seedless grapes that you buy and you sell in the UK are made in and planted here. But the Spanish market just simply doesn't take it because it goes for taste.
It seems British taste buds pay for year-round fruit and veg.
I'm absolutely convinced that there is a trade-off between getting, you know, everything looking the same, getting your product in a way that you can transport it very efficiently, making it very attractive and very perfect for the looks of the consumer and the taste. There's no doubt in my mind about that.
The trade-off Carlos was talking about became totally clear when I spotted a basket of weird-looking green tomatoes.
Now, this chap here, this is hilarious, because he might win a prize in an unusual vegetable competition.
Yeah.
There's no way he would be on a shelf in a British supermarket, not that I've seen, anyway.
Well, I would believe you, but it is the best tasty one, and it carries a premium here. And it tastes completely different.
Mmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
This is more in keeping with the ones we're used to, the sort of big, juicy red one.
Yeah, this is what Spain exports to the UK.
Mmm. That one's much better, the little misshapen chappy.
Yeah, yeah.
Unlike the British, the Spanish still buy most of their fresh produce from markets. So what would Madrid shoppers think of our perfect-looking UK supermarket fruit?
Pues le falta sabor total.
Bueno, más o menos. Un poco ácida.
Pues yo los he consumido aquí y son un poquito más dulce, con más sabor.
Este tomate es insípido para mí.
No me gusta. No son dulces. Muy buena presencia, pero no saben a nada.
No vale nada.
So I'm beginning to understand the difference between supermarkets across Europe and those back home in the UK. People here shop differently. They like to touch their food, they like to smell it, and they certainly like it to have taste. Plus, they know what's in season. Back home, we don't seem to know or care about any of that. So what happens is that our supermarkets are able to sell us what suits them, what suits their system.
It seems that all they need to do to get us to buy things is to just make sure that it looks perfect.
Next, more supermarket secrets. What's in your kids' packed lunch? And the myth of cheap supermarket produce. Supermarkets like to claim credit for the fact that on average we're spending much less on our food than we used to.
That's to do with all of us, you know, the whole society getting more affluent. It's not true for the people on the lowest incomes. They still spend just as much on food. And I think this is a great myth. Supermarkets haven't given us cheap quality food. They've given us some foods at a loss, which are fantastically cheap, but it's very expensive to eat well now.
Supermarkets might keep the price of known value items like white bread and milk artificially low, but what about fresh produce?
Well, I'm off to my not-so-local greengrocers now, hence the car. When I was a kid, my mum had quite a range of local shops to choose from, but for most of us, that's very much a thing of the past. And it's a popular perception that if you buy your fruit and veg in the supermarket, it's going to be a lot cheaper than if you do manage to find a local provider. So I thought I'd put that to the test. Look, how fresh is that? It's still got the soil on it. Never see that in the supermarket. Strawberries. I wonder if they're Al Santa.
I made sure I was comparing like with like by buying the same quantities of similar quality supermarket fruit and vegetables.
Okay, so this is the shop that I did this morning at my little not-so-local greengrocer's. Then I went to the three supermarkets that are nearest to my house. That's Tesco, Sainsbury's and Asda. What about the prices? Well, the supermarkets all came out very, very similar in price. Of course, they're locked in price wars, so they keep a sharp eye on this. But here's Tesco's. That was the cheapest at £7.30. Then we had Asda at £7.59. Then Sainsbury's was slightly more expensive at £7.63. So what about my local greengrocer? Well, a lot of people we spoke to said that they shop at supermarkets because they say that they're cheaper. Well, £6.61 at my local greengrocer. So proof, if you need it, that today this was the cheapest.
If fresh supermarket produce isn't cheap, prepared fruit and vegetables are downright expensive.
Things the supermarket love is added value, which is where you take something that's really essentially a very simple product for which you can't charge very much and do something to it in order to be able to charge much more. So the classic example is the bag of salad.
Salad. To save you time, we pick it, trim it, wash it, mix it, and pack it. In fact, all you have to do is pop it and take it off the shelf.
This advert appeals to our lazy side.
Every little helps.
And it works. Bagged salads exploded onto the market in 1992. Now over 60% of us buy them regularly. And boy, have they been a nice little earner for the supermarkets.
I've just bought this bag of prepared iceberg lettuce from Asda. And at the same time, I bought this whole iceberg lettuce. Now, the one in the bag cost me 66 pence for 200 grams, whereas the whole one cost me 58 pence for 512 grams. That's a 300% markup by Asda. Still, look on the bright side.
It must have saved me, at least 30 seconds. And there's another thing. There's more in some salad bags than just bagged salad. Inside, there's a special cocktail of gases, which prolongs its shelf life by up to 10 days. It's called modified atmosphere packaging.
And the whole idea is to slow down that living process, or really to slow down the process of deterioration.
once they're opened, of course, they then have a very short shelf life, because suddenly the processes that we've slowed down in this modified atmosphere suddenly all kick in again, and very quickly.
Maybe that explains why I'm constantly chucking away bags of ready-washed salad that seem to go manky in the blink of an eye. All over Britain, we parents worry about what we're feeding our kids. Experts tell us they're getting fatter and fatter, and more children are being diagnosed with diet-related illnesses, like type 2 diabetes. Ever since Jamie Oliver told us about some of the rubbish that can be found in school dinners, parents up and down the country have been preparing packed lunches for their children. They want them to have simple, nutritious food. But take a look at this lot. Let's start with this drink. It's from the Sainsbury's Blue Parrot Cafe range, and it says on the packaging that it's a range of healthier foods for kids that's been developed with nutritionists. But healthier than what? This orange juice drink, in fact, doesn't have that much orange juice in it, only about 10%, and it has more sugar than a can of Coke. But surely fresh fruit and veg must be really good for children, like this chopped melon, for example, ideal for lunchboxes. Trouble is, recent research by Which magazine has shown that pre-prepared packaged melon like this can lose up to 58% of its vitamin C content. What's more, the supermarkets are making a fortune out of the packed lunch market. You pay through the nose for handy packs like these carrots, which can cost up to three times more than if you bought fresh carrots and prepared them yourself. And even those handy little cheeses like this Sainsbury's Red Leicester can end up costing nearly twice as much as cutting and wrapping the cheese yourself. So there you have it. Supermarkets like to give us added value, but who really gains? They say they make our lives easier. But is convenience really worth the cost to our animals, our farmers, our environment, and most of all, our food?
They're not about being great grocers or supplying us with good food or supporting British agriculture or being nice to turkeys or helping working mothers find good food for their children. That's not really what they're about. What they're about is making money, and they do that ruthlessly and very effectively.
40 years ago, shopping was a time-consuming business, but shoppers knew what to look for and what it was worth. Today, the supermarkets want us to think that they do all of that for us, on our behalf. Personally, I think it's high time we relearned some of those old shopping skills.
Gillian McKeith has loads of advice on the grub you chew. You Are What You Eat, Wednesday at 8:30. Next up, the people with extreme obsessive-compulsive disorders. Will treating them together in the same house cure them of their obsessions?